Refutes Darwinism, Part 3. Far from being a scientific thesis, Darwinism is a system of thought invented and sustained in order to lead people to deny Allah, and one that is constructed upon errors. Darwinists have neither scientific foundation nor any evidence with which to defend their position. In order to sustain their irrational and unscientific theory, they resort to fraud and demagoguery and seek to silence their opponents with psychological pressure and methods of indoctrination. The fact is, however, that they are in a hopeless position. That being the case, it is a grave error for any Muslim to be taken in by evolutionist propaganda and to attach any credence to this theory. Nonetheless, because of the inferiority they feel when confronted by evolutionists and out of ignorance, doubt, or lack of determination, some people have engaged in a superstitious attempt to reconcile Darwinism with faith. Someone who fails to keep up with the scientific progress and who does not read publications setting out the invalidity of the theory of evolution may be taken in by Darwinist deceptions. However, lack of awareness is a state of affairs that can easily be overcome by reading about the subject. No Muslim with detailed knowledge concerning the theory of evolution can any longer possibly remain undecided or silent in the face of evolutionist claims. In this third and final part of our series, The Qur'an Refutes Darwinism, we shall continue to examine the errors of those who attempt to find evidence for the theory of evolution in the Qur'an. Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, was not the first human being. One of the claims made by those taken in by the idea of creation through evolution is that the Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, may not have been the first human being, and that he may not even have been human at all. Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, is beyond this. Those making such claims point to the following verse as evidence. I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. When your Lord said to the angels, I am putting a khalif on the earth, they said, why put on it one who will cause corruption on it and shed blood when we glorify you with praise and proclaim your purity? He said, I know what you do not know. These people interpret the Arabic verb Ja'ilun, used in the expression, I am putting a caliph on the earth, as meaning to appoint in English. They then errorly conclude from this that the Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, was not the first human, and that he was appointed caliph from among many human beings. The fact is, however, that the verb Ja'ilun does not only mean to appoint, but also it is used in various places in the Quran to impart such different meanings as to create, bring into being, invent, convert, make, do, place, etc. Some of the verses in which the verb Ja'alun is employed read as follows. I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. He created you from a single self, then produced Ja'ala, its mate from it, and sent down livestock to you, eight kinds and pairs. Say, it is he who brought you into being and gave. Waja'ala, you hearing, sight and hearts, what little thanks you show. And placed the moon as a light in them and made. Waja'ala, the sun a blazing lamp. Allah has spread, Ja'ala, the earth out as a carpet for you. As can be seen from these verses, the word Ja'ala is used in very different meanings in the Quran in addition of to appoint. Yet even if the sense of to appoint is applied to the word ja'ala, it is still incompatible with the Quranic moral values to draw the heretical conclusion of creation through evolution. Allah tells us in the Quran that angels, jinn, and Satan were all created before the Prophet Adam, peace be upon him. When the Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, was created, the angels were required to prostrate themselves before him. And they all did this, with the exception of the jinn, Diabolus. Therefore, even if the word Ja'ala is interpreted as meaning to appoint, it is still clear that the Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, is being referred to as being appointed caliph over the angels and jinn. Allah knows the truth. In addition, after his descent to earth, the Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, was appointed caliph over a human society consisting of his own descendants. And this is another sense in which the idea of being appointed is appropriate. All this goes to show the word Ja'ala in the verses do not, contrary to what some people maintain, mean that the Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, was chosen from among several people who existed together with him. The Quran contains no statement in support of such a claim. To make such an impossible suggestion on the basis of a single word is a sign of a serious lack of reason and judgment. Furthermore, it is clearly stated in several verses that the Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, was created out of earth. These verses make it clear that the Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, was not just one human being from among many, that he was the first human being, and that his was a very special and different creation. Allah states in one verse as such, I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. The likeness of Jesus in Allah's sight is the same as Adam. He created him from earth, and then he said to him, Be, and he was. Another important piece of information provided by the Quran with regard to the Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, being the first human being, is the way that he and his wife were expelled from paradise because of the errors of their ways. Allah states in the verses, I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. Children of Adam, do not let Satan tempt you into trouble as he expelled your parents from the garden, stripping them of their covering and disclosing to them their private parts. He and his tribe see you from where you do not see them. We have made the Satans friends of those who have no faith. We said, Adam, live in the garden you and your wife, and eat freely from it wherever you will. But do not approach this tree, and so become wrongdoers. But Satan made them slip up by means of it, expelling them from where they were. We said, Go down from here as enemies to each other. You will have residence on the earth and enjoyment for a time. The expressions in these verses are crystal clear. Allah created the Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, out of earth. Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, was created in a very special manner, and this can be seen from his initial presence in and subsequent expulsion from paradise. However, those who espouse the false idea of evolutionary creation ignore these evident facts. They propose the irrational idea that the word paradise in the verses refers not to paradise in the hereafter, but to pleasant places on earth. Yet it is clearly revealed in the Quran that the Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, and his wife were first placed in paradise and then subsequently sent down to earth. There is no Quranic evidence or basis for the claim that the word paradise in the verses refers to pleasant locations on earth. This claim consists entirely of illusory speculation built upon conjecture and guesswork. It is a serious error to attempt to look for evidence for the theory of evolution in the Quran by way of such irrational and illogical interpretations when the expressions used in the verses are so clear. There are several verses that indicate that all human beings are descended from the Prophet Adam, peace be upon him. In other words, that he was the first human being. One such verse says, I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. When your Lord took out all their descendants from the loins of the children of Adam, and made them testify against themselves, "Am I not your Lord?" They said, "We testify that indeed you are." Lest you say on the day of resurrection, "We knew nothing of this," or lest you say, "Our forefathers associate others with Allah before our time, and we are merely descendants coming after them. So are you going to destroy us for what those purveyors of falsehood did?" In short, the Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, was the first human being, the first messenger of Allah, and the forerunner of all humans. The verses on this subject are so clear as to permit no other interpretation. Anyone reading the Quran with a sincere heart and devotion, and heeding the voice of his conscience, will, by Allah's leave, accurately interpret these verses and see the truth. The error of thinking that the term forefathers in the Quran refers to evolutionary forebears. Another term that those people taken in by the idea of evolutionary creation seek to portray as evidence from the Quran is the word forefathers, which appears in several verses. According to evolutionists' erroneous interpretations, this expression supposedly refers to human beings as primitive evolutionary ancestors. They imagine this is justified by the word being used in the plural in the Quran. Some of these verses are as follows. I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. He said, "Your Lord and the Lord of your forefathers, the previous peoples. There is no God but Him. He gives life and causes to die. Your Lord and the Lord of your forefathers, the previous peoples." It is clear what an illogical claim this is. Anyone of normal intelligence can easily see that the term forefathers in these verses refers to previous generations of the community it addresses. One can also see how trying to force evolutionist interpretations onto such a clear and transparent term stems from a serious lack of judgment. All in all, the fact that the term forefathers is used in the plural represents no evidence for any evolutionist interpretation. There are several other verses of the Quran in which the term appears. In verse 133 of Surat Al-Baqarah, for instance, which reads, I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. Or were you present when death came to Jacob, and he said to his sons, "What will you worship when I have gone?" They said, "We will worship your God, the God of your forefathers, Abraham, Ishmael, and Isaac, one God. We are Muslims submitted to him." The term forefathers is also used in the plural here, yet the subject here is the generations that lived before the Prophet Jacob, peace be upon him, rather than any evolutionary process of the kind evolutionists maintain. Human creation. I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. Allah caused you to grow from the earth. Then will you return to it, and He will bring you out again. This verse is one that is generally misused by people who espouse the falsehood of evolutionary creation as a supposed justification for their views. Evolutionists interpret the expression "caused you to grow from the earth" as evidence for a supposed inorganic evolution. The fact is, however, that as indicated in many commentaries and exegetic texts, it actually refers to the creation of the first human being out of the earth. In the verse, Allah compares the creation of a human being from earth to the emergence of a plant from the earth. It is just as easy for Allah to create a human being out of inanimate earth as it is for our Lord to produce a plant from inanimate earth. In short, the verse contains a very wise simile for the creation of human beings from the earth. Hamdi Yazir of El-Mali makes the same statement in his commentary. There are two aspects to the verse. The first is that saying that he caused you to grow from the earth means that he produced your father from earth, creating your line by first producing him from the earth. The other is that he created you all from earth, because Allah creates us from the soil, and then from mud, from the earth. Omar Nasuhi Belman interprets verses 17 and 18 of Surah Nuh as follows. Consider this, Almighty Allah caused you to grow from the earth. In other words, your first father, the blessed Adam, was created out of earth, or brought into bodily form from the essential matter that provides your food. In that way, people have developed, grown, and found a natural habitat. Later, that great power will return you to the earth. In other words, when you die, you will be cast into the earth and will again become one with the earth. Later still, he will bring you out of the grave again. These are all signs of the truth. In his commentary, Tabari interprets the verse as meaning, Allah has created you from the soil of the earth. He has brought you into being from nothing. He will later restore you to your original form, in other words, to earth. You will return to the form you had before you were created. When he so wishes, he will bring you forth alive once more. You will be restored to your living state in this world. As can be seen from the commentaries of great Islamic scholars, it is impossible to interpret these verses in such a way as to regard them as evidence for the error of evolutionary creation. The error that the Quran points to natural selection. One of the main claims made by the theory of evolution is the delusion that natural selection is an evolutionary force. Modern science has revealed that this claim, first made under the primitive scientific conditions of the 19th century when Darwin was alive, is totally unfounded. In other words, it has revealed that natural selection has no mechanism permitting the development of existing life forms or the formation of new ones. But evolutionists blindly devoted to Darwinism ignore this fact in the face of science and constantly strive to keep the nonsense that natural selection is an evolutionary force on the agenda. Their aim is to impose a theory of evolution, which is devoid of any scientific foundation, on people lacking sufficient knowledge of the subject by way of indoctrination and propaganda. Ignorant people influenced by such evolutionist indoctrination and propaganda thus imagine the lie that natural selection is in fact an evolutionary force to be a scientific fact. They even go so far as to look for evidence of this in the Quran. One of the verses these people point to as supposed evidence for their claims reads, I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan, Your Lord creates and chooses whatever He wills. The choice is not theirs. Glory be to Allah. He is exalted above anything they associate with Him. This verse states that the Almighty Allah is the only one who creates and selects, and that Allah Himself will choose the people, messengers, and prophets on whom He will bestow salvation. The theory of evolution's claims regarding natural selection is the delusion that living things were selected through evolution as a result of natural events, and that this led to the emergence of new species. As we have seen, the meaning of this verse has nothing to do with evolutionist claims. Not the slightest inference pointing to any evolutionary natural selection can be drawn from it. Therefore, to claim there is a sign for evolutionary natural selection in this verse will be an imprudent act. Islamic scholars are also unanimous in interpreting the verse in the sense we have outlined. Imam Tabari, for instance, interprets it by saying, "Our Lord creates those servants He desires and chooses from among them, those He will give faith and guidance. They have no right to choose. They have no means of doing what they desire." The great commentator Omar Nasuhi Belmin also interprets the verse as meaning, "In those holy verses, Allah declares His creative power, that He favors and chooses whom He wishes, His wisdom and might, His unity, His meriting praise and splendor, His divine command, and that all His servants will be summoned to His spiritual presence." In other words, no one could prevent the Almighty's favoring and choosing in any way. Whatever His servants choose is not effective on their own. With all due respect, Allah is not obliged to create what they favor and prefer. Allah does not send His prophets upon the preference and opinion of the people to whom He has sent His prophets, but only upon His divine preference. Only He knows how and by which means goodness and prosperity will manifest. He has no partners, nothing may exist against His eternal will, and no one's will may be against His exalted determining and selecting. Hamdi Yazir of El-Mali interprets the verse thus, "Our Lord selects and creates that which He chooses." In other words, He creates what He chooses and selects what He wishes from those things He creates. He elevates to great tasks such as prophethood. They have no right of choice. For that reason, they have no right to ascribe other partners to Allah and to choose and appoint other deities. A second verse that some Muslims who espouse the idea of evolution indicate as supposed justification from the Qur'an for their views on natural selection is the first verse of Surah Fatir. "I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. Praise be to Allah, the bringer into being of the heavens and earth, He who made the angels, messengers, with wings, 2, 3, or 4. He adds to creation in any way He wills. Allah has power over all things." They point to the expression "He adds to creation in any way He wills" as a proof of the alleged evolutionary development. But it is clear that this is a totally fictitious and groundless interpretation. The verse first refers to the special creation of the angels, and then says that our Lord adds to creation as He chooses. The expression "He adds to creation in any way He wills" refers to the number of wings of the angels in question, and also, more generally, to all the entities created by Him. Imam Tabari interprets this term as meaning, "He adds to the number of angels as wings as He chooses. He can apply this addition to all beings. Creation and command are His." Omar Nasuhi Balman interprets the verse in the same way as Imam Tabari, saying, "He is so all-powerful that he gives the angels a number of wings and powers they possess." As we have seen, the expression, "He adds to creation in any way he wills," implies nothing whatsoever about creation through evolution. There are many examples of Allah adding to creation, and whom he makes superior to whom in the Quran, and none bear any evolutionary meaning. Allah states which of his creation he makes superior in various verses. When the superiority in question refers to human beings, this may take various forms such as strength, beauty, wealth, intelligence, knowledge, rank, or esteem. Allah can also add to the blessings he bestows when he so wishes. He may add to someone's wealth and property, or the number of his children. He may also create greater beauty and strength in whomsoever he wishes. Another example of his adding to creation is that of produces. In verse 4 of Surat Ar-Ra'd we are told, "And we make some things better to eat than others." Despite their emerging from the same soil and being irrigated with the same water, Allah can add to the flavor or productivity of whatever goods he so chooses. Countless other instances of Allah's adding to creation could be cited. Allah knows the truth. However, it is irrational and illogical to think that anything about such a clear, open, and transparent expression could be equated with any alleged evolutionary process. That the Quran contains evidence for mutation. In addition to natural selection, another natural phenomena indicated as a so-called evolutionary mechanism is that of mutation. Mutations are damages caused in the genetic structures of living things by agents such as heat, radiation, or chemical substances. Mutations damage and disrupt the DNA sequence in the living cell. There is no such thing as a beneficial mutation. 99% of mutations are harmful, and the remaining 1% has no impact at all. A living thing subjected to mutation generally ends up crippled and defective, or else gets down with diseases such as cancer stemming from genetic impairment. In short, mutations add no new information to DNA, for which reason mutations cannot endow a life form with any new characteristics or organs. No evolutionary effect of mutations has ever been observed to this day. As with the subject of natural selection, the proponents of the delusion of evolutionary creation look for so-called evidence from the Quran. They come up with a number of irrational and illogical claims by distorting the true meaning of verses in their search for supporting evidence. The verses to which they appoint as supposed evidence for the nonsense that living things evolved by way of mutations are as follows. "I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. If we wished, we could transform them where they stand, so they would neither be able to go out nor return. You are well aware of those of you who broke the Sabbath. We said to them, 'Be apes, despised, cast out.' Then, when they forgot what they had been reminded of, we rescued those who had forbidden the evil and seized those who did wrong, with a harsh punishment because they were deviators. Say, shall I tell you of a reward with Allah far worse than that? That of those whom Allah has cursed with and whom He is angry, turning some of them into monkeys and pigs, and who worshipped false gods. Such people are in a worse situation and further from the right way. So he threw down his staff, and there it was, unmistakably a snake. The first verse describes how Allah will punish some people by putting their bodies into a different form, in which they cannot move. The three following verses describe how Allah turns some people's bodies into other livings' bodies, again as a punishment. The final verse describes how Allah turned the Prophet Moses' peace be upon him staff into a snake. None of these things happened as a result of natural causes, but as the consequence of Allah's miraculous creation. All these transitions referred to in the verses happened in a miraculous way, with this telling them to be. They did not occur through evolution or mutation. It is nonsensical to seek to establish any link between these verses and the theory of evolution. The verses describe how Allah turned some people whom He punishes for their evil deeds into apes or pigs. Even if we imagine that these changes did not take place instantaneously, it is nevertheless clear that they must take place within the average human life expectancy of 60 to 70 years. Nevertheless, the theory of evolution foresees it taking millions of years for one species to turn into another. The Prophet Moses' peace be upon him staff, the subject of the final verse, is an inanimate object, for which reason it cannot even be suggested that it underwent evolution. It is even more nonsensical than the claims made by evolutionists to suggest that an inanimate staff suddenly turned into a dragon by way of mutations. If someone is not laboring under the delusion of thinking, I must produce some evidence in favor of evolution from the Qur'an. Even if I have to distort it, then it is absolutely impossible to interpret the verses in question as evidence of mutation. Indeed, attempting to produce evidence from the verses in favor of evolution in that way merely proves what a hollow, forced, and un-Qur'anic thesis evolutionary creation truly is. The error that the Qur'an indicates, a familial link between humans and apes. One of the verses misinterpreted by some people who have succumbed to evolutionist indoctrination concerns the way that Allah once turned a group of Jews into apes. The verses in question read, I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. You are well aware of those of you who broke the Sabbath. We said to them, be apes, despised, cast out. We made it an exemplary punishment for those there then, and those coming afterwards, and a warning to those who have taqwa. Those who defend the lie of evolutionary creation maintain the erroneous thesis that this verse contains a family link between humans and apes. It is obvious that no such meaning running parallel to the theory of evolution can be extracted from this verse. There are several distinct reasons for this. The punishment in question may have been a spiritual one. In other words, these Jews may have been made to resemble apes in terms of character, rather than physically. Allah knows the truth. If the punishment in question did take place on the physical level, then such an event can only have occurred outside the laws of nature, through Allah's so willing it, in the form of a miracle. Yet the theory of evolution maintains that one species turned into another slowly and gradually over the course of millions of years as a result of natural conditions and coincidences. The words, "We made it an exemplary punishment for those there then and those coming afterwards, and a warning to those who have taqwa," in the following part of the verse, show that the transition referred to took place during the time of the Jews in question. In other words, over a very short space of time. This event revealed in the Qur'an has therefore nothing to do with the fallacies of the theory of evolution. The punishment described in the verse refers to one specific instance and applies to one specific time and a specific number of people. The theory of evolution, on the other hand, maintains the illogical and unscientific scenario of all the humans who have ever lived being related to apes. The verse refers to humans being turned into apes, whereas the theory of evolution claims the transition ran in the other direction. In verse 60 of Surat Al-Ma'idah, Allah refers to a corrupt community being turned into pigs and apes. The verse runs as follows. I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. Say, shall I tell you of a reward with Allah far worse than that, that of those whom Allah has cursed and with whom He is angry, turning some of them into monkeys and into pigs, and who worshipped false gods? Such people are in a worse situation and further from the right way. If persisted with the erroneous logical framework we have been examining throughout this film, then one must arrive at the irrational conclusion that the verse indicates a familial link not only between humans and monkeys, but also between humans and pigs. Yet not even evolutionists claim there is any such relationship between humans and pigs. Conclusion. We have seen the following reality in all three sections of our film series, The Qur'an Refutes Darwinism. There is not a single verse or expression in the Holy Qur'an that constitutes any evidence for Darwinism. On the contrary, the verses of the Qur'an show that human beings and all living things are the work of the Almighty Allah's commandment that they should be, and of His flawless creation. The Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, was the first human being created, and all human beings are descended from him. The groundless claims to the effect that some verses contain evidence in favor of evolution are totally based on misinterpretations, distortion, and irrational, illogical, and fantastical imaginings. Anyone with a normal intelligence can see the illogicality and ridiculousness in the way that evolutionists depict certain verses of the Qur'an as so-called evidence for Darwinism. They will also see how lacking in foresight, reason, and honesty that mindset that looks for evidence for evolution in the Qur'an truly is. No conscious Muslim can possibly subscribe to Darwinism, a theory targeted against the true faith and the fact of creation. To ignore the global damage caused by this theory, to underestimate it, and to avoid engaging in the intellectual struggle against it are unacceptable. As we stated at the start of this film, lack of information is a significant factor in people's falling into such an error. Yet subscribing out of ignorance to a corrupt ideology such as that of the theory of evolution, which denies Allah, creation, and the true faith, imposes grave responsibility on the individual. It is therefore of the greatest importance in terms of the hereafter for Muslims to keep away from such errors. In the Quran, Allah stated on the subject as thus, I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. Do not pursue what you have no knowledge of. Hearing, sight, and hearts will all be questioned.